In Leviticus chapter 4, and if we have time, we're going to read a little bit in it later about the sin offering. But what kind of sins did the sin offering of Leviticus 4 cover? Sins of ignorance. Now, that was sins of ignorance in the sense that I didn't know that such and such to do was wrong. But have you ever had a sin of ignorance where you did something wrong and you didn't realize it? Or you didn't mean it, but it happened that way? I'm sure that probably over this camp meeting, I probably have offended someone. I've trespassed at least, maybe through ignorance. And I'd like to tell you that if you just come to me and share with me that trespass, I will be more than glad to try to make it right. I don't want anything against my record in heaven tonight. And I hope you don't either. On April the 8th of 2003, then Chief National Security Advisor Condoleezza Rice addressed the 9/11 Commission. The nation had been rocked by terrorist attacks 19 months before, and the country was still reeling from those assaults. The people were wanting answers as to why the country was not better prepared. Had the executive branch of the government no warnings? Had they let down their guard? Dr. Rice addressed the commission to share with them some of the behind-the-scenes information concerning the matter. The administration's credibility had been damaged, and Dr. Rice attempted to clarify and vindicate the work of her department and that of the administration before the people. And I'd like to say that God has, in effect, been called before the commission of the universe to stand trial. In Revelation chapter 14, in the beginning of what we call the three angels' messages, it says very simply this, "And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment has come." Friends, it's true. God enters into a judgment. And there is something that we called last night the investigative judgment. But in this judgment, God Himself is also on trial. And He must be vindicated. But He's not going to use His own testimony. You know, it really is a universal truth that by your own testimony, you can hardly ever justify yourself. You always get into the he said, she said, and who knows who's right, you know. You almost always have to have someone else vindicate you. And this is why when many times as Christians we are accused of doing wrong, it's best not to respond. It's best to take higher ground and let God take care of those battles for us. Isn't that right? We're told that Satan had accused God of requiring self-denial of the angels when he knew nothing of what it meant himself. And when he would not himself make any self-sacrifice for others, this was the accusation that Satan made against God in heaven. And after the evil one was expelled from heaven, he continually charged the Lord with exacting service, which he would not render himself. Christ came to the world to meet these false accusations and to reveal the Father. Because according to Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3, Jesus is the express image, and the Greek says the express or the exact character of the Father. Jesus says, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. God's answer to Satan's charges and to sin that followed is very simply summed up in one word, atonement. Atonement, or this concept of being at one. We who had become out of harmony, out of this pulsation with God's heart of love, are brought back into a position of at-one-ment. And there's going to come a time, as we will see if we have time, as we have time, that there will be a time when this whole universe will be in agreement with God. Isn't that right, Sister Annika? That's right. And I don't teach universalism either. Now, I would like to share with you some contemporary thoughts on this concept that we call final atonement. Remember last night we had some circles, and circles within circles, and what was in the very middle circle, do you remember? Very good. And in the next circle was cleansing the sanctuary, and the outside circle is final atonement or day of atonement. That's right. And I've purposely left off the references at first. I can give them to you later if you want. But I want you to tell me if you think these are true or false. Can we do that? Let's find our theology tonight. The summary in Hebrews 10:18 makes it clear that the new covenant is currently in force for Christians. Would you agree with that?
What is it?
The new covenant is currently in force for Christians? I mean, no question about that, is there? Let's go on. The author concludes, and notice how this writer says the author of Hebrews. He's not sure who it is, but that should give you some clue, right? The author concludes the entire lengthy theological section of Hebrews 8, 1 through 10 and 18 with several astonishing affirmations. First, the repeated sacrifices of the Mosaic Law have been forever rendered obsolete by the final atonement of Christ on the cross. Does that sound pretty kosher?
No.
Well, you know, I got both answers here. Let's read on. Let's go on. This is another reference. The Day of Atonement, Leviticus 16. Not martyrdom shapes Hebrews' picture of Christ as high priest obtaining redemption in the heavenly temple, referenced Hebrews 9, 12 through 15. Here, redemption amounts to full and final atonement for sin as Christ, not animal blood, is substituted for the lives of sinful humans. Is this statement kosher and good?
No.
I hear one strong no. I see a lot of puzzled faces.
It's not final.
Well, I'm going to give you another statement. But this one I'm going to tell you where it comes from. Oh, you know what? I've just loaded the question, haven't I? I've just loaded the question. Not everything Froom wrote was wrong.
Amen.
Let's see about this one. He's writing in Ministry Magazine of February 1957. Now, what had happened in 1955 and 1956 that Leroy Froom was heavily involved in? He was involved in a series of conferences with other leading Adventist ministers and leading evangelicals in America on discussing whether Adventism could legitimately be called and understood and fellowshipped with as a Christian denomination, as opposed to how it had been viewed by many people as a cult. Okay. And so the evangelicals met with these leading brethren, and they had dialogues, and these evangelicals presented questions to the Adventist brethren. And the answers that the Adventist brethren had was going to determine whether they could be accepted as Christian or rejected continually as a cult. The answers were refined, they were edited, and they were finally published with the questions in a book entitled Seventh-day Adventists Answer Questions on Doctrine. And so Questions on Doctrine became the short title, sometimes just simply known as QOD. Prior to the publication, though, the way was being prepared by Leroy Froom and Roy Allen Anderson, who also participated in the conferences. Please remember that prior to this, Leroy Froom had been head of the Ministerial Association of the Church. At this time, Roy Allen Anderson is now head of the Ministerial Association of the Church. He is also the editor of Ministry Magazine. And so they're beginning to publish articles that are hinting and explaining about what you're going to be hearing next coming out in this book, Questions on Doctrine. And Froom wrote this: "That is the tremendous scope of the sacrificial act of the cross, a complete, perfect, and final atonement for man's sin." Good or bad? Kosher or orthodox?
Bad.
bad. Now I want you to notice in this statement a punctuation mark. And it's in the second line that you see on the screen here. It's called a dash. You see the dash? When do we use a dash? What is a dash used for grammatically? It gives an explanation of something. I looked it up and looked according to some grammatical experts. And they say it's used to set off a word or phrase after an independent clause or to set off a parenthetical remark. The dash interrupts the flow of a sentence and tells the reader to get ready for more. It's an explanation of what's coming or, you know, of what we've had. And so the sacrificial act on the cross, according to grammatical definitions, means that that is the same thing as a complete, perfect, and final atonement for man's sins. In other words, you could even put, as it were, an equals mark there. Now, there was someone who read this sentence. And you know what? They didn't like it. And they started to write against it. And that was Emil Andreassen. And he quoted this statement, but he quoted it just a little different. I want you to notice how he quoted it when he's writing in his letters to the churches. He says, that is the tremendous scope of the sacrificial act of the cross is a complete, perfect, and final atonement for man's sins. That's what he did. And the question now we have to understand is, did he grammatically respond correctly? Did he perhaps manipulate, misquote, or misrepresent Froome? I would like to propose to you, first of all, that despite his theology, Froome was an excellent writer. And he had an excellent command of the English language. And yes, he knew exactly what he was doing. He wrote exactly what he wanted to write. If he wanted to mean that this was a final sacrifice for sin, he would have said so. But instead, he wrote that it was a final atonement. Now, in the year 2007, there was a book published for the 50th anniversary of Questions on Doctrine. And you know what it was? A reprint of Questions on Doctrine, but it was called an annotated edition because it had notes in it by George Knight. And this apostate, George Knight, attempts to... It's not funny, but it's true. It's that's the truth. He attempts to twist or spin the history in the new edition of Question on Doctrine, and there he noted this. Andreassen's discontent had begun to surface with the September 1956 publication In Eternity, with its assignment of those who held his position on the sinful human nature of Christ to the lunatic fringe of Adventism. Eternity was a magazine published by Dr. Donald Barnhouse. He was a Presbyterian minister in Philadelphia who had a large radio program, went across the nation. Okay? And here George Knight is quoting Barnhouse, but he misrepresents Barnhouse in this quotation. Now he's just accused Andreassen of misrepresenting Froome. Why do I say that? Because if you look at the term lunatic fringe here, do you see that? It's in double quote marks, right? That means that should be in double quote marks like that somewhere else. However, let me just show you something. This is Barnhouse in September 1956, Eternity Magazine, and he's writing. And he's writing about these conferences that he and Walter Martin, remember Walter Martin?
Yeah.
Okay, authority on the cult, supposedly. That he and Walter Martin were having with Froome and Anderson, T. E. Unruh, Walter Reed, Field Secretary for the General Conference. He says they, and that's who he's talking about when he says they, Froome, Anderson, and this group, or Frieda, as it was actually called. There was an acronym, Frieda for it. They further explained to Mr. Martin that they had among their number certain members of their, quote, lunatic fringe, end quote, even as there are similar wide-eyed irresponsibles in every field of fundamental Christianity, end quote. Now, the quotes, the quote marks here for lunatic fringe, those are not the words of Barnhouse. They were the words of Frieda to Barnhouse. And so when Knight was quoting here, it should have been a quote within a quote. And he didn't accurately reflect that. He didn't put the onus on our brethren for calling people like Andreessen part of the lunatic fringe. They call it lunatic, you know, because it goes to the moon, right? That's right. And so George Knight continues. George Knight continues and he says this. That smoldering discontent broke out into the open when Froom published a February 1957 ministry article on the Atonement. We looked at just a sentence from that earlier, okay? Same article. Especially offensive to Andreessen was a sentence referring to Christ's death that Christ's death for every sinner that read. That is the tremendous scope of the sacrificial act of the cross, dash, a complete, perfect, and final atonement for man's sin. What Froom meant by that sentence was that the sacrifice on the cross was a full and complete sacrifice in terms of the sacrificial aspect of the atonement for sin. But that is not the way Andreessen read it on February 15 when he misunderstood and misquoted Froom's words. Andreessen repeatedly quoted Froom as saying that the sacrificial act on the cross is a complete, perfect, and final atonement for man's sins. But Andreessen's rendering of Froom's sentence changed his meaning. The word is not in Froom's original sentence. But if you look back at the way it's quoted by Andreessen, it's quoted in brackets, friends. And when you quote something in brackets, that means it's something you are adding or putting in to clarify the matter. Andreessen was not trying to say that that was what Froom said in the technical exactness. Well, but he was showing that he was adding that word. There's no question that Andreessen was saying, I've added this word here, but I think it fits. And grammatically it does fit. But it's interesting that even in a roundabout way, Knight admits it. But watch. Watch what he says. The word is not in Froom's original sentence. Rather, he followed the word cross with a mid-sentence dash with the words following the dash functioning as an explanatory phrase to the several words that went before it. Is this not doublespeak at its best?
Or it's worse.
Thus, Froom's meaning was that the cross was a completed sacrifice or the sacrificial aspect of the atonement. Now, notice there it's in parenthesis. That's Knight's writing, not mine, not my insertion, because if I was inserting something, I would put brackets. But Andreessen, in quoting Froom, removed the dash and supplied the word is in parenthesis. With that one small stroke, he changed Froom's meaning from a complete sacrifice or sacrificial aspect of the atonement on the cross to a completed atonement on the cross. And that just isn't accurate. That is not correct. I think there's one more part here. That interpretation, of course, put Froom and his colleagues out of harmony with traditional Adventism, which had often used atonement exclusively to refer to Christ's heavenly Day of Atonement ministry. Now, I think it's so paradoxical, that if you read the introduction, you continue reading the introduction, Knight will try to spin this, and he's going to try to tell you that Froom and Andreessen basically believed the same thing. They just got mixed up on the semantics of it. That's what Knight says. But I think it's interesting that neither Froom nor Andreessen ever agreed upon the idea that they were in agreement. And further, we have the testimony of Froom through Barnhouse, which was never repudiated. And that testimony said this. And this is Barnhouse writing in that Eternity magazine of 1956. Barnhouse says, it, and he's referring to the sanctuary teaching, notes this in brackets, is to my mind, therefore, nothing more than a human face-saving idea. It should also be realized that some uninformed Seventh-day Adventists took this idea and carried it to fantastic, literalistic extremes. Let me just pause here. He's talking about uninformed people like Jay in Loughborough, uninformed people like Jay in Andrews, uninformed people like James White, uninformed people like M.L. Andresen, who taught at the seminary and was president of two colleges at the same time. Well, what about these extremes? Mr. Martin and I heard the Adventist leaders say flatly that they repudiate all such extremes. This they have said in no uncertain terms. Further, they do not believe, as some of their earlier teachers taught, that Jesus' atoning work was not completed on Calvary, but instead that it was still carrying on a second ministering work since 1844. This idea is also totally repudiated. They believe that since his ascension, Christ has been ministering the benefits of the atonement, which was completed on Calvary. And that phrase, ministering the benefits of the completed atonement at Calvary, you're going to see again. I promise you that. And by the way, you might wish to know that Barnhouse got into a phone conversation one day with Al Hudson. Anybody know who Al Hudson was? You remember who Al Hudson was, surely. He was the printer at Baker, Oregon, who printed 1888 Reexamined and printed Letters to the Churches by Andreasen. He got into a phone conversation with Al Hudson, and Al Hudson recorded the conversation. He didn't tell Barnhouse, but he recorded it. But in that conversation, Barnhouse said, "Christ hates the Sabbath." That's the kind of individual that we were dealing with, at least theologically. Now, we have been given, friends, a trust. We have been given a sacred trust. In Adventism, we call ourselves Seventh-day Adventists. And to a degree, it does rightly represent some of our main teachings, some points that are important to us. But I would like to propose to you that Seventh-day Adventism is not simply about Seventh-day worship, and it's not simply about the coming of Christ, because there are other churches that teach the Seventh-day Sabbath, and there are many churches that teach that Jesus is coming soon, and they all don't teach a rapture. What makes us unique, and the only thing, friends, that makes us unique, is the sanctuary doctrine and the way we understand it and believe it. And that is what Adventism is. That's what the final atonement is all about. In 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 20, if you would turn with me there, Paul, writing to Timothy, says, "O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust. Avoid profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science falsely so called." He says, Timothy, he says, you've had something entrusted to you, and you are to hold on to it, to keep it. This expression, committed to thy trust, it's a long Greek expression. It's one word. But what it means literally is something laid down beside you. Something laid down beside you. You've been given this trust. It's been given beside you. I've laid it down beside you, and you are to care for it. In 2 Timothy 3:14, Paul says, "But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them." Do you think the early church had to deal with anything called new theology? You bet. Every group of people, every group of Christians God's tried to work with, there's always been a new theology. And it hasn't ceased. And it didn't cease in Adventism. And it didn't cease within the movement about God. I'm just telling it like it is. Popular or not. But our message, the three angels' messages, is centered around the sanctuary doctrine. And I think we all probably know this next statement by heart from Great Controversy, page 409. The scripture which above all others had been both the foundation and the central pillar of the Advent faith was the declaration unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. She says this is the foundation, the central pillar of Adventism, of our message. She says concerning this, One of the landmarks under this message was the temple of God, seen by his truth-loving people in heaven, and the ark containing the law of God. This is important. This message is important. You know, we have this question about Christ. What is he doing now for us? And I understand that we have to explain this a little bit more, and I hope to expound on this, especially Saturday night, if the Lord wills. But Ellen White just makes this very simple statement, and it helps us to fit a lot of the theology in. She asks the question, now Christ is in the heavenly sanctuary, and what is he doing? Making atonement for us, cleansing the sanctuary from the sins of the people. And there's going to come a day, friends, when Jesus says, he that is just, let him be just still, and he that is unjust, he'll be unjust still. And this is all going to end, and probation for all humanity is going to close forever and ever. And our sins are either going to be cleaned up or not, and we are going to have to live in the sight of a holy God without a mediator. How long? I don't know. You know, some people think a year, some people have other ideas based on prophecies of Revelation and so on. But we realize, friends, it's going to happen. And it doesn't matter to me if it's a day, if it's a year, or 10,000 years. Because if you are sealed and if you have participated with Christ in this final atonement, you will never, ever sin again. And it doesn't matter how long it is before Jesus comes, you will never sin again. But Jesus is not simply ministering the benefits of the atoning sacrifice on the cross for us. He's making atonement for us now, and there is a distinction. And we as Adventists must understand this distinction. In Psalm 77:13, we quoted it last night. You know what it says, thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great as God as thee? God's way of working, friends, especially today and for the remnant people, is in the sanctuary. And if you go back to Exodus chapter 25 and verse 8, he says, let them make me a sanctuary. Why? Wait a minute, he didn't say, let them make me a sanctuary so that I can remove their sin. That's not what he said, did it? He said, so that I might dwell among them. But friends, our God is a consuming fire. Hebrews 12:29. I ask you, is God ever going to cease being a consuming fire? What is he a consuming fire to? Sin. To sin. Isaiah 33. We have the question asked in verse 14. The sinners in Zion are afraid. Fearfulness has surprised the hypocrites. Who among us shall dwell with the devouring fire? Could we say, without doing injustice to the text, who among us can stand in the presence of God Almighty? Who among us shall dwell with everlasting burnings? And the answer is given in verse 15. He that walketh righteously and speaketh uprightly, he that despises the gain of oppression, that shaketh his hands from holding of bribes, that stoppeth his ears from hearing of blood, and shutteth his eyes from seeing evil. Mm-hmm. Friends, he's talking about people who have experienced atonement, and specifically, final atonement. The Bible says that we are to be holy because he is holy. And this, I tell you, is what Adventism is about. It's about being at one-ment with God. It's being able to dwell amidst the devouring flames without being burned up. And this is something that we need now. I don't know your individual lives. I don't know what you do when you go home. I don't know what you do when you're alone in your bedroom at night, or when you're out driving alone, or where you're going, but you do. And as we read this morning, what was the term that we used this morning for the records that started with an M?
Manum.
Our manum. Is that for memory?
No, it's for
man. Man, okay. Well, as we heard this morning, there have got to be billions of pieces of data in heaven written about each one of us. And they're being written tonight. They're being written every moment we breathe. And if the sin is not taken out of our lives, it can't be removed from the record of heaven. Yes, I have a backlog of billions of sins recorded in heaven. And God is able and willing to wipe everyone off, but He's got to wipe it out of my life first, friends, before it can be blotted out in heaven. I was at Andrews University Chapel for some meetings, and a very well-known theologian whose name you would recognize quickly if I mentioned it was in the pulpit preaching, and he's made the statement. He said, "I'm so glad Jesus will be mediating for us until He gets here." Why would He say that? Why would He need to say that? Because He believes, according to his theology, we're going to continue to sin until Jesus comes. You see, their plan is to sin and repent, sin and repent, sin and repent. But God's plan is trust and obey. Amen. Now, the sanctuary is not the end of the means, but it is the means to the end of God dwelling with His people. For God to dwell in His people, He must have a way to free them from sin, or He will destroy them. And that way is the sanctuary. The sanctuary has the whole message of redemption within it. It is the truth that unifies all the principles of our faith. We've been told in Great Controversy on page 488 and 489, the sanctuary in heaven is the very center of Christ's work in behalf of men. It concerns every soul living upon the earth. It opens to view the plan of redemption, bringing us down to the very close of time and revealing the triumphant issue of the contest between righteousness and sin. It is of utmost importance that all... How many, Sister Dorothy?
All.
All. That all should thoroughly investigate these subjects and be able to give an answer to every one that asketh them a reason of the hope that is in them. We saw a video where Brother DeMario was interviewing people, and I don't know if that interview ever got turned around and they maybe asked you what you believed about the issues, you know, they didn't. But here's the thing. People are going to ask us. We are going to have opportunities. We will have to give an account for our faith. And 1 Peter 3:15, it tells us that we are to sanctify the Lord God in our hearts and be ready to always to give an answer for the hope that's in us with meekness and fear. And that's what she says here. She says, it is of the utmost importance that all should thoroughly investigate these subjects and be able to give an answer. She goes also on to say, Satan is striving continually to bring in fanciful suppositions in regard to the sanctuary, degrading the wonderful representations of God and the ministry of Christ for our salvation into something that suits the carnal mind. Let me just stop here for a second. You know what suits the carnal mind? That you can sin till Jesus comes. That's okay. That's what suits the carnal mind. He removes, this is Satan, removes its presiding power from the hearts of believers and supplies its place with fantastic theories invented to make void the truths of the atonement and destroy our confidence in the doctrines which we have held sacred since the third angel's message was first given. Thus, he would rob us of our faith in the very message that has made us a separate people and has given character and power to our work. And you know that all those statements in Series B, number 2, 7, and so on, were all written just a little past the turn of the into the 20th century, the early 1900s, when Dr. Kellogg was promoting his pantheistic ideas, which were based, of course, on the Trinitarian doctrine. But she says that we cannot do this, we cannot go this way. Satan is trying to make void the truths of the atonement. Ellen White had stated over 20 years before that it is as certain that God lives that we have the truth. Why do we need to change? Why do we need to make these changes? And I want to assure you that we have made changes. And most people are not even aware. But as Barnhouse said, and we quoted earlier, he said that the people that he and Froom were meeting with, I'm sorry, he and Walter Martin were meeting with, which was Froom and Anderson, Undrew and Reed, that they strenuously denied that we were believing now what we used to believe, that we had made changes to accommodate. Now, in this sanctuary service, there were two central focal points, and Brother Carter nicely hit upon a couple of those yesterday. We went into Leviticus 4, and we're going to look at it here in just a minute. And Leviticus 4 deals with something called forgiveness. And Leviticus 16 deals with something called cleansing. And one of them represents justification, and one of them represents sanctification. But all of this was done in the Old Testament under what we call shadows or examples of heavenly things. In Hebrews chapter 8, we read it last night, but we should read it again. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 1. Now of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such an high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and the true tabernacle, which the Lord pitched and not man. For every high priest is ordained to offer gifts and sacrifices, wherefore it is of necessity that this man have somewhat also to offer. Verse 4. For if he were on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law. Now verse 5. Who serve unto the example and shadow of what? Heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern shewed to thee in the mount. And going on into chapter 9, and I believe that this was also touched upon earlier, verse 1, Paul begins a summation of what all this was about. It says, then verily the first covenant had ordinances of divine service and a what? Worldly sanctuary. But there's a heavenly sanctuary, isn't there? And that heavenly sanctuary was used to make the blueprint or the pattern that this sanctuary was. This sanctuary was simply a shadow of the heavenly sanctuary. Verse 2. For there was a tabernacle made, the first, wherein was the candlestick and the table and the shewbread, which is called the sanctuary. And after the second veil, by the way, if there's a second veil, what does that by necessity imply? First veil, read about in Hebrews chapter 6. And after the second veil, the tabernacle which is called the holiest of all, which had the golden censer and the ark of the covenant overlaid round about with gold, wherein was the golden pot that had manna and Aaron's rod that budded, and the tables of the covenant. And over it, the cherubim of glory overshadowing the mercy seat, of which we cannot now speak particularly. Now when these things were thus ordained, the priests went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God. When it says they went always, it means that they went daily. And I think that was brought out well the other day, that this happened on a daily basis. There was a ministration going into this, the first apartment. It says verse 7, but into the second went the high priest alone once every year, not without blood. In other words, he went with blood, which he offered for himself and for the heirs of the people. The Holy Spirit, this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest, while as the first tabernacle was yet standing. Verse 9. Which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience, which stood only in meats and drinks and divers washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of reformation. But Christ, being come a high priest of good things to come, by a greater, more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption. For us is supplied, but it's fine. Now, this last phrase, obtained, having obtained, what tense is that? Normally we would read that as past tense. But the Greek can also be translated differently. The ESV, it says, he entered once for all into the holy places, not by means of the blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own blood, thus securing an eternal redemption. The Revised Standard Version says something very similar. He's securing it, but it doesn't mean it's finished, you see. But there are two main services here brought out by Paul. He sums it all up. Now, we heard this morning about the trespass, and the trespass is a wonderful, important thing. And it's essential for us to know. We learned that. But in Paul's summation, he speaks about this daily service, the sin offering, and he speaks about the once-a-year offering, the Day of Atonement. And so we'd like to look at those for just a little bit, because I think they're important to us tonight. Can we do that? And then we want to look at some, well, we may not have time, but we're going to look at some linguistic ties in how this takes Daniel 8:14 and brings it in to Leviticus 16:30. Can we do that? Is that okay? So let's go to Leviticus 4 first. Leviticus chapter 4. Now in Leviticus chapter 4, and I think it was brought up accurately earlier, that there are four categories of sin offering involved here in Leviticus chapter 4. And I'll start by reading verse 1 and 2. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, if a soul shall sin through what?
Ignorance
against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning things which ought not to be done, and shall do against any of them, then here's what you do. And you start out, and you have these different categories. The first thing it says, if the priest that is anointed do sin. And here's a procedure. Now, I won't take time to read through all of it, but there's a procedure now for the priest who's anointed, and this refers to the high priest. There's also a procedure in verse 13. And if the whole congregation of Israel sin through ignorance. In other words, if there's corporate sin, the whole nation has done something wrong. And now there is a procedure. And in verse 22, when a ruler has sinned and done somewhat through ignorance against any of the commandments of the Lord, here's what you do for that. But now there's something else that's been left out, and it's the most important thing. And what has been left out here so far? Me, you, the common people, the individual. Our individual accountability. And he actually lists this through two different ways and two times, but the procedures are very similar. But let's move down to verse 27. And if any one of the common people sin through ignorance, why does somewhat against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning things which ought not to be done and be guilty, or if his sin which he has sinned come to his knowledge, then he shall bring his offering, a kid of the goats, a female without blemish, for his sin which he hath sinned. And he shall lay his hand upon the head of the sin offering, and slay the sin offering in the place of the burnt offering. And the priest shall take of the blood thereof with his finger, and put it upon the horns of the altar of burnt offering, and shall pour out all the blood thereof at the bottom of the altar. And verse 31, and he shall take away all the fat thereof, as the fat is taken away from off the sacrifice of peace offerings, and the priest shall burn it upon the altar for a sweet savor unto the Lord, and the priest shall make an atonement for him, and it shall be forgiven him. It says that there is an atonement made here. That's what it says. It says the priest makes an atonement. And this represents the work of Christ at Calvary. And that work is a work that provides forgiveness.
That's right.
Provides forgiveness. Now, it's true, as we mentioned, I think, also the other day, that when you read this procedure through, the blood was ministered at the brazen altar, the burnt offering, not the golden altar inside the holy place. That was done for the other two, the first two that we mentioned there, but not here. But according to Leviticus 6:26, the priest was to take a portion of this offering and he was to eat it. And he was to minister that offering then through his going into the holy place. He would thereby transfer that sin even into the holy place in that daily service. And it is an atonement. But it's not the only atonement. And it's not the final atonement.
Amen.
In Leviticus chapter 16 now. Perhaps someone better versed at how to do this quickly than I will give an overview of the procedures of the Day of Atonement. But you can read it in the 16th chapter of Leviticus. You understand it involved several offerings, especially we think of two goats, the Lord's goat and the scapegoat, or Azazel. And it all comes down, though, it culminates down to us in verses 29 and 30. And this shall be a statute forever unto you, that in the seventh month, on the tenth day of the month, ye shall afflict your souls and do no work at all, whether it be one of your own country or a stranger that sojourneth among you. For on that day shall the priest make an atonement for you, to cleanse you, that ye may be clean from all your sins before the Lord. Now there's an atonement of cleansing. And this is not just simply any atonement. This is the atonement of all atonements. This is the pinnacle. This is it. This is the most important day in all Israel.
Amen.
In Leviticus chapter 23, in verse 27, and I'm going to read this to you. I'm going to read this to you more accurately as the Hebrew renders it than your King James Bible probably renders it, but it's only going to be a very small change. So listen carefully. Also on the 10th day, I'm in Leviticus 23, 27, also on the 10th day of this seventh month, there shall be a day of atonements. It shall be an holy convocation unto you, and ye shall afflict your souls, and offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. And ye shall do no work in that same day, for it is a day of atonements, to make an atonement for you before the Lord your God. Now, what did I change? Just ever so slightly in the text.
Yes.
I added plurals in a couple places, because the word atonement in Hebrew is kafar. Kafar. It literally means to cover. But it has a plural form, and the plural form is kapur. And the Hebrew word for day is yom. And you've all heard of yom kippur. You didn't hear of yom kafar. You heard of yom kippur. It means the day of atonements. Why would they call it the day of atonements? Well, in a sense, there was more than one atonement made. That's true.
Atonement of atonements.
But it's the atonement of all atonements. It's a use of the majestic plural, the plural of majesty, showing the superiority of this atonement over any other atonement. This is the focal point of God's redemption in bringing man to this final at-one-ment with Him. Now, we know that Daniel 8:14 says, "Unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed." But in Leviticus chapter 16 and verse 30, the Bible says that He's performing this atonement so that you might be clean, to cleanse you from all your sins. And the Hebrew word that's translated in Daniel 8:14, you probably know. Anybody remember what it is? I know you know, Thomas. Don't tell everybody. It's tzedak. Tzedak. You should remember that. It's tzedak. But the word translated in Leviticus 16:30 is a different word. It's taher. It's taher. But what I want to show you now in the next few minutes, before we have to close, is that there is a very clear biblical linguistic connection between these two words. And particularly I want to talk to you about tzedak. Because tzedak, it comes from another Hebrew word, tzedek, which has, with tzedak, a family of nuances, but they're all basically the same meaning, but they carry a broad concept in the Bible. In fact, I want to propose first, it carries the concept of judgment, vindication of the righteous, and even punishment of the wicked. I want to show you some verses to substantiate that. So let's turn our Bibles now to Psalms chapter 7. Psalms chapter 7. And I'd like to read verses 8 and 9. It says, "The Lord shall judge the people. Judge me, O Lord, according to my righteousness." And this word for righteousness is tzedek. And it's related to tzedak. It's the word tzedak actually comes from. And it says, "And according to mine integrity that is in me, O let the wickedness of the wicked come to an end, but establish the just, the tzedek, for the righteous God trieth the hearts and reins." And then if we would turn to Psalms 9, because it's close by. Psalms 9. And I read starting in verse 4. For thou hast maintained my right and my cause. Thou settest in the throne judging right. And that word right is tzaddik. Verse 5. Thou hast rebuked the heathen, thou hast destroyed the wicked, thou hast put out their name forever and ever. O thou enemy, destructions are come to a perpetual end, and thou hast destroyed cities, their memorials perished with them. But the Lord shall endure forever, he hath prepared his throne, judgment. And now verse 8, and he shall judge the world in righteousness, tzaddik. He shall minister judgment to the people in uprightness. In Psalms 51, you're familiar with Psalms 51, aren't you? Psalms 51 and verse 4. David says, against thee, thee only have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified. The Hebrew word is tzaddik. It's the exact same word that's in Daniel 8, verse 14. That thou mightest be justified when thou speakest and be clear when thou judgest. And so we see this word has a broad meaning. It's used also in the context of salvation in Psalms 98. Psalms 98 and verse 2. The Lord hath made known his salvation, his righteousness. And this is another variation. It's tzaddikah. It's his tzaddikah hath he openly shewed in the sight of the heathen. And if you turn with me to Psalms 119. And verse 123. I don't know about you, friends, but I'm the kind of person that's hard to convince. Are you ever hard to convince? Do you like to have good evidence? Is it unfair to offer and to suggest we should have good evidence? I think we should have good evidence, friends. We should have preaching and messages that we need not repent of. To borrow Paul's language from Romans. He says, my eyes fell for thy salvation and for the word of thy righteousness. I'm in Psalms 119, verse 123. 1, 2, 3. I'll read it again. My eyes fell for thy salvation and for the word of thy righteousness. And this is the Hebrew word, tzaddik. Let's go to Isaiah now. Isaiah 53 and verse 11. In Isaiah 53, the chapter about the sufferings of Christ. It says, he shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify. Tzaddik. Many, for he shall bear their iniquities. And in Isaiah 45 and verse 24. Isaiah 45, 24. Jonathan, you're doing really great. And you just keep listening to me. I appreciate what you're doing right now. And I haven't forgot. Okay. Isaiah 45, 24. He says, surely shall one say, in the Lord I have righteousness. And this is the Hebrew word, tzaddikah. And strength, even to him shall mankind, and all that are incensed against him shall be ashamed. Verse 25 also. In the Lord shall all the seed of Israel be justified, tzaddik, and shall glory. Now, I mentioned that there was another word, and that word is found in Leviticus 16:30. And what did we say that other word was? Taher. Very good. And let's look at some verses now where we see both of these words used together. Is that okay? In the book of Job, Job chapter 4 and verse 17, because it's a verse you should be familiar with if you've ever given Bible studies on the state of the dead, I think. Job 4:17. Job 4:17. Well, in fact, I'm going to read this verse, but I'm going to tell you about part of it because I probably should read a couple more verses here. Because tzaddik, again, it has such a broad meaning. It includes the concepts of cleansing and purification. Now, I'm going to show you how it ties in with Tahir here, maybe in just a minute more. But in Job 4:17, it says, shall mortal man be more just? And the Hebrew word is tzaddik. Then God, shall man be more pure than his maker? And we'll come back to this verse again in just a little bit. So hold your place there. But go to Psalms 19 and verse 9. Psalms 19 verse 9. It says, the fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and what? Righteous. They are tzaddik. altogether. So you begin to see some of the nuances of the way that this word tzedakah in its various forms have. Vindicate, righteous, justified, you know, all these concepts. Purified. Interestingly, there was a priest of Salem. Do you remember his name?
Melchizedek.
And that name Melchizedek comes from the Hebrew word for king and tzedak, the righteous king. In summary, concerning the Hebrew word tzedak and its derivations, we could say that they are associated with such concepts of judgment, vindication, and they are associated with righteousness, salvation, purification, and cleansing. All of these concepts are exactly, my brothers and sisters, what the Day of Atonement is about. And tzedakah conveys the additional thought that God's character will be fully vindicated as the climax of the hour of His judgment. Now, I mentioned to you that this Hebrew word translated cleanse in Leviticus 16:30 is tahir. And the Hebrew words tahir and tzedakah are sometimes used interchangeably. And we would like to look at that again. I told you to keep your hand in Job 4:17. So go back to Job 4:17. Let's read it again. And I think that even the neophyte here sees that we have Hebrew parallelism, right? And Hebrew parallelism means that you say a statement one way, you say the same statement in another way, and they are the equivalents. And it says here in Job 4:17, shall mortal man be more just, tzedakah, than God? Shall man be more pure, tahir, than his maker? And so here you have together in parallel the English word just with the English word pure, but they come from the Hebrew words tzedakah and the Hebrew word tahir. And Job 17:9 has a similar arrangement. If we go to Job 17:9, here you have the righteous tzedakah also shall hold on his way, and he that hath clean tahir hands shall be stronger and stronger. And so it's clear that the words tahir and tzedakah are interchangeably connected in the Word of God. And we see that they convey this oneness, but I'd like to propose to you that I think that the word tzedakah conveys an even deeper meaning to what the Day of Atonement is all about. It's not just about cleansing, but it's also about vindication, it's about salvation, it's about judgment, and more. Now, I should just note in making this connection here that the translators of the Hebrew Bible into Greek, and we call the Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible the Septuagint because it involved 70 Jewish Hebrew Greek scholars making this translation of the Hebrew text, that they chose to translate the word tzedakah in Daniel 8:14 into the Greek katharizo. And this same word is also the same word that they translated in Leviticus 16:30. In other words, they had two different words in Hebrew, but when they translated into the Greek language, they actually used the same word. And this same word is also, and it's Strong's 2511, if you'd like to have the Strong's number, if that helps you. But this is Daniel 8:14, an English translation of the Septuagint. And he said to him, evening and morning there shall be 2,300 days, and then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. But you see here, it's this Greek word that we were talking about earlier, katharizo. And then in Leviticus 16:30, you see this word, it's used actually twice. It's used to represent cleansed. It's used to represent purged. In Hebrews chapter 9, in the New Testament, Paul, not the author of Hebrews, Paul, I make no apologies for that. Paul uses this same word here we translate it as purged. It says, it was therefore necessary that the patterns of things in the heavens should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. And so we see here, friends, that Adventism has not been following cunningly devised fables. in making this connection between Daniel 8:14 and Leviticus 16:30. God is going to make a man more precious than fine gold, than the fine golden wedge of Ophir. And he's not going to make just simply an individual. He's going to have a righteous nation that keepeth the truth that's going to enter into the kingdom. And I believe that with all my heart. And friends, if you don't, you don't know what Adventism is. This is the truth. This is the truth that Christ is doing something special right now. Sometimes we are accused of having a different standard of salvation. You know, we expect if Martin Luther is going to be true, is going to go to heaven, that he had to keep the Sabbath, he had to believe in all these things that we believe in today. But we believe Martin Luther will probably go to heaven. Best we understand, Luther will be a saved man. We believe William Miller is going to be a saved man because we've been told the angels are watching his grave, waiting for the resurrection morning and the coming of Christ that he was so interested in looking for, right? But he was a Trinitarian Sunday keeper, believed in the immortal soul. How in the world is God going to take him to heaven? God understood Miller's heart. And you know, Ellen White, she says that there were people who wanted to share the truth with Miller as he was older. And other people brought confusion to his mind and prevented him from understanding the truth. But God knew where his heart was, and God can save that man. But I'm going to tell you, that isn't going to work in the end of time. If you're going to be translated, friends, there is a different standard. There's a standard of full and total cleansing. And if you want to be a part of that group that live is living without ever seeing death when Jesus comes, then you have to have this experience. You have to have this experience. This isn't an optional thing. We go into classes in college and we take these elective classes. We call them electives. You have requirements and you have electives. But friends, in the end, they're all requirements for us as Christians. I'm going to tell you they're all requirements. And I want to tell you what else. I'm glad that they are. I'm glad that they are. I don't want to go to heaven, friends, halfway. Do you? Was it Sister Christie the other day in the health lecture? She said, you know, I'm sort of one of those all-in or nothing persons, right? Yeah. Don't you want to be that way? Sure. Don't you want to be the way Jesus wants you to be? Jesus said, Matthew chapter 5 and verse 48, he says, be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. And I know we can look at the context of Matthew chapter 5 and it's talking about loving our enemies. But that's one of the hardest things in the world there is to do, is to love our enemies. But we must do that. But our Father in heaven is very perfect. He's very perfect. But God's biddings are His enablings. Do you believe that?
Amen.
Christ Object Lessons, page 333. All His biddings are enablings. Not one requirement has He ever given to man without giving him the ability to live that requirement. I'd certainly like to say more, but my time is up. But I want to thank you for being with us. And I want to just make this call tonight as I close. If you cannot obey 1 Peter 3:15 tonight, and if you don't remember what 1 Peter 3:15 is, then you do need to look it up. If you can't obey 1 Peter 3:15 tonight, it's time to get on the stick and put yourself in a position where you can. And not only in what you can give in a Bible study. You know, the apostles, they had an advantage over us. They could quote the scripture and they didn't have to give chapter and verse. Right?
Or say it word for word.
Peter, well, they came a lot closer on that than we give them credit for, and I'll tell you why. Because when we read, for instance, Peter quoting Joel on the day of Pentecost, he says, you know, the prophet Joel said. And we look at the text and they don't seem to be exact, but that's because Peter is quoting from that 70, the Septuagint. He's not quoting from the Hebrew text. Virtually every text that's quoted in the New Testament of the Old is from the Septuagint. And they do read a little differently, but in context they mean the same thing almost always. So we may not know every chapter and verse, but we need to know. And we need to know above all experientially. We need to have these things in our lives, you know, living them out day by day and moment by moment. Someone made the statement that they were witnessing or speaking to someone, they just didn't have a tract to give them. Someone said that earlier tonight, I think. But you know what, friends? And then that, and we, it'd be good to do that. That's right. It'd be good to have that track on you. But we are living epistles known and read of all men. Our very life is a track. Maybe it's a booklet. You know, Joseph Bates, he printed a track on the Sabbath and the way marks and the high heaps, and it was like 46 pages. You know, I don't call that a track, but that's what they called a track in their day. Maybe they printed booklets too. But friends, we have so much. Now, I've not even touched on my message tonight, really only half of it at most. But we have 2 minutes and we need to have prayers, so we're going to close our meeting. But I want to make an appeal to you that if you don't understand and can obey 1 Peter 3:15 in connection with what we're talking about here tonight, it's time to learn to obey the Word of God. And if you understand it intellectually, it's time to live it. Do you want to do that? Is there anyone who wants to do that tonight? I mean, I hope we all want to do that. Do you believe Jesus is wise enough to teach you how to do it? Amen. You know, the Bible says that all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are hid in God in Christ, so He's got the wisdom. Do you believe He has the power to do it? Amen. He says, all power in heaven and earth is given unto me. So where's the problem? That's right. That's right. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the blessings of Jesus. We thank you for the blessings of this message tonight. And we thank you, Father, that you've given us a sure foundation, that your way is in the sanctuary and you've given it to us as a people. And Father, the mainline church, we know they've repudiated this. We've seen that over and over. But Father, we here tonight, we want a better way. And we ask you to work in our lives that better way and to give us the righteousness that we need, Father. We can't obtain it of ourselves. We acknowledge that. But through Jesus, we can be among those who dwell in the devouring fire, who walk righteously and speak uprightly. It can be in all that we do. And so, Father, forgive me if where I have failed. Forgive me if where I have trespassed against you and against these people and others as well. And bring me into a saving, close relationship with Jesus in a way that I've never been before. And I ask this same thing for each and every one here. So please bless thy people tonight. And I thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.